Hi, everybody. Today I'm going to talk about another topic regarding entomology, specifically the importance of migration to butterfly and moth populations. Migration is a very important part of the life cycle of lots of butterflies and moths, although it's not very common, to be honest. There's a lot of species. The majority of butterflies and moth species are very sedentary, meaning they have very focused ranges and they don't migrate much. But there are notable exceptions, and the way humans behave and the way humans are stewards of their environment is very important to be able to map and track and also protect the migration routes of these particular butterflies and moths. So probably the most important migrator that I'm sure everybody has heard about is the monarch butterfly. The monarch butterfly is very well known, and it is a very strong migrator, at least most populations are. And this species, as an adult, ranges from Canada all the way to Mexico, and individuals overwinter in the mountains of Mexico in the fir forests at high elevation. And they have spectacular breeding aggregations in the mountains of Mexico. So a lot of people have some misconceptions about migration. Like, what do they do? Do they all make the flight at once? But they don't necessarily make the flight at once. So this is an example of the queen butterfly, which is the same genus, the same family as the monarch. And the queen butterfly doesn't migrate very much, very rarely. Most of these live in the southeast US down into the Caribbean and also Central and South America. And they have a very sedentary existence. They don't migrate much. The monarch starts off in the spring in Mexico, and individuals fly up through Mexico into the southern United States, through Texas and California, and reproduce. So an individual monarch doesn't go from Mexico to, say, New York or Connecticut. It will have several generations that it takes to get up from Mexico to, like, basically the Northeast. Because the butterflies don't live that long. There's a lot of challenges along the way. So the butterflies that you're seeing now, like in the fall in Connecticut, are going to be one or two generations separate from the moths that left Mexico in the spring. And then basically when they get these subtle cues from the environment, they turn around and decide to return to Mexico, which is a mystery that science is still trying to figure out how they do this. But it's like when it gets cooler, the monarchs turn around and start flooding back south, usually along the coast. And a lot of people will see a lot of monarchs around this time of year because monarchs are extremely, they're very sensitive to cold, so they cannot survive winter temperatures in the Northeast. So they have to immediately return south. So over multiple generations again, a lot of adult monarchs will actually move from, say, the Northeast down to the Mid-Atlantic or the Southeast, and then have another generation, and then those next generation monarchs will continue to Mexico or the Caribbean. So again, a single monarch usually doesn't make the whole trip. There might be a few that are strong enough to do it, but most of them take a couple generations to make the trip. And so given how we can affect migrators becomes very apparent when I talk about these next two species, which are called, this is the common painted lady, which if you have children, a lot of people sell rearing kits for these, where children can rear butterflies from eggs to adult, and they're called painted ladies. They're a very common species. And this butterfly here is called the common snout. They're called snouts because they have a little, like, their palps are kind of pointed into it looks like a nose. This is another migratory species, and sometimes in the Southwest, these things are so abundant that there could be literally swarms of billions of them flying through the Southwest, and people have drove through them, and it just darkens the skies. There's so many of these. So when it comes to migrators, the common denominator in a lot of these is the Southwest. So in the southwestern United States, you have a lot of concentration of butterfly diversity, and a lot of our species that we get up into the Northeast of all different types pass through that area. And so a big challenge for going forward for humanity is to actually protect the areas, not only in Mexico, in Latin America, where these species overwinter, but also protecting habitat that these species use as corridors to basically fuel up for their journey. So old farmland, old fields, abandoned areas with flowers are very important for basically preserving the habitat of these butterflies and moths. And a lot of these butterflies actually feed on, like these feed on milkweeds. So if you have milkweeds in your yard, don't chop them down, keep them, because these butterflies will use them both for fueling the next generation and also food for nectaring. So, and another issue is associated with the border wall that's unfortunately being proposed to going up along the Texas and New Mexico and California border. And this wall is having the adverse effect of potentially destroying lots of key habitat for butterflies and moths right along the Texas border. And there is a very strong center of diversity in southern Texas. It's one of the most species-rich areas of all the areas of the United States for butterflies. And actually, one of the major butterfly gardens in southern Texas is actually partially destroyed by construction crews that are building the wall. So even by doing things that seem to be based more focused on humans, they have adverse impacts on the environment by causing that destruction to the habitat, both to the plants that the insects depend on, and also killing potential caterpillars, eggs, and pupa of adult butterflies and moths as well.